Good evening, everybody. Welcome. Welcome to Cedars-Sinai for this very important event. I could see already from the feedback that we've been receiving this past few weeks that there's a lot of excitement about this event. We have a very, very wonderful group of speakers tonight, and so we want to get started. The format will be as follows. We're going to see a little video very briefly to learn about Maaseh HaYeshua Medical Center in Bnei Brak, a very unique, incredible place. It was actually Rabbi Bess Shlita who had introduced me to Maaseh HaYeshua, and I had an opportunity to visit it a few years ago, and I was blown away. One day, Cedars-Sinai will be like Maaseh HaYeshua. I'm joking. Maybe. You never know. That's quite something to aspire to. Maaseh HaYeshua is a very special place, as we'll find out about in the video. Then we'll hear from Tzvika Reisman a little bit, some personal reflections about Maaseh HaYeshua and Dr. Rothschild. And then we have Professor Strauss, who we'll hear about as well. Very, very honored to have Professor Strauss, someone of his caliber, to share with us some insights tonight. And then we'll have a professional panel of local experts. The panel, each of the panelists will address us for a few minutes. And then we'll have a chance for some questions. The way we're going to do it, because we want to run everything smoothly and on time tonight, is that there already are some note cards and pens that you were able to take as you came in. I will again be going around the room during the panel, just before the panel, making sure everyone who wants to has a note card and a pen. And if you want to submit a question, just please write it down on the note card, and I'll walk around the room every few minutes, and you can hold it up. I'll take your note card, and we'll take as many of the questions as we have time for. I'll read them to our panelists just to keep everything moving in an orderly fashion. So we really are very excited to welcome you tonight. Thank you for coming. Without further ado, we'll start the video.
The White-Robed Angel, That's what everyone called B'nai B'rak's local doctor, Dr. Moshe Rothschild. This angel treated every child for free, as if he were his own son, and every elderly woman as if she were his own mother. He studied Torah and healed, prayed and treated patients, truly embodying the sacred combination of medicine and Torah. He had a vision, too. In order to save lives in B'nai B'rak, one must establish a medical center that combines advanced medicine with the preservation of Jewish law. Armed with a dream and determined to see it through, Dr. Rothschild set out on his life journey to create a new medical institution. No one believed it, but with endless determination, he gathered penny by penny, established facts on the ground, and shared his vision with the generation's leaders. Only one thing matters, the sanctity of life. Protect the value of life. Even for people who in other facilities might no longer have been treated, and maintaining human dignity everywhere and at all times. He began building his medical facility. In the year Tashan, 1990, like a miracle, and by force of one man's faith, a man of spirit and action, the Mayanei HaYeshua Medical Center is inaugurated. This is how the doctor explained his success. When a Jew plans a project with the goal of the sanctification of life, he will surely be supported from above. This exceptional doctor sought to heal the physical body, but he also saw inward, into the person's soul. For the first time in the world, he established an unparalleled state-of-the-art mental health center suited for religious and Haredi patients. The uplifting combination of professionalism, compassion, and serenity led to a breakthrough in community medicine and increased awareness of mental illness. There is charity just as valuable as money. Lending an ear, listening to someone who is suffering. It is a symbol and beacon, imparting dignity to a tormented soul. For three decades, the founder, Dr. Rothschild, and his medical staff lead the Mayanei HaYeshua Medical Center, establishing a reputation of uncompromising professionalism, medical excellence, with personal attention for each patient. The medical center has become very much in demand in Israel. It is undergoing a period of continual construction and development. The center has doubled operations over the last 3 years, expanding into a campus of three buildings, with new departments utilizing the world's most advanced technologies. Dr. Rothschild's vision is embedded in every stone of Mayanei HaYeshua. Professionalism, soul, and dedication will continue to guide the center for generations to come. I was born for this purpose.
As you can see, Mayanei HaYeshua is a truly unique, incredible hospital that functions completely in accordance with halacha. It's a completely Jewish hospital. And when I visited Mayanei HaYeshua and Rabbi Bess introduced me to Dr. Rothschild, the one thing that he took me outside to show me was this high-rise mental health facility, that functions completely in accordance with halakha that they were building at that time that now is built and has become a leader, a world leader in Jewish mental health care. To hear some personal reflections now and to be introduced more personally to Dr. Rothschild, we have the honor of calling upon one of our leaders of our community, leaders of Torah, supporters of Torah, really unique, wonderful person, Tzvika Reisman.
Good evening, Rabbonim, Dr. Rothschild, General Manager of the Hospital, Mr. Fachler, Khan Lichbad. After the Six-Day War, Moshe Dayan decided he wants to ride Jeep. He took the Jeep to Kvish HaSargel. This is a road between Afula and Beit She'an. It's a straight road, that's why it's called the Sargel, it's a ruler. He took the Jeep and drove very fast, 140 miles, not kilometers an hour. A policeman runs after him, runs, catches him in Beit She'an. Do you know you're driving fast? To drive fast? Impossible. Look at the speedometer. I have only one eye. I can't look at the road and the speedometer at the same time. Moshe Dayan had one eye. Rabbi Dr. Rothschild had two. And soon I'll tell you that he had three. He was a leader. And he had a vision. He came from Switzerland as a doctor, a pediatrician, but at the same time, a businessman, Ish Asakim. He decided to combine both and bring it to Israel, to Bnei Brak, which is Ir HaTorah, just Torah, just learning. And he came in and he sees no hospital. 250,000 people with no hospital. Yes, there are other Fum Aloha hospitals. The first one was 100 years ago, Dr. Wallach built Shari Tzedek. Yes, another one in Netanya, the Klosenburg Rebbe built another hospital as well. The difference is the hospital of Dr. Wallach was in Yerushalayim, was mainly a city of Fum people, but many non-Fum, and even Arabs at that time, and even today. Netanya, when the Klosenburg Rebbe came, was primarily a non-Fum town, a town chiloni, non-religious. And he decided, I'm going to do it. Dr. Rothschild went to a Fum town. We know how difficult it is. We know how it's almost impossible. Dr. Rothschild was not giving up. He went to Hasidische Rebbes, to Litvische Rebbes, Sfardische Rebbes to convince him. And they, all three of them, didn't have only two eyes. They had three eyes. There's a midrash in Parshas Emor, this week's Parsha. The Midrash is comparing the four minim in Sukkot to parts of the human being. The shedra, the spine, is like the lulav. There's one spine, one lulav. The etrog, the esrog, is like the heart. There's one. We take only one lulav, one esrog. The arava, there are two aravot, it compared to the lips, to the two sfatayim. The adas is compared to the eyes. Ask the Ish Bar Chai, I don't understand. There are two eyes, and we take three adasim. Should be three adasim and three eyes. Says he, yes, we have three eyes. Two eyes up front and ayin asichlit, but we don't use it too often. Those three people, the three doctors, the three rabbis, the three leaders, the three visionaries, had ayin asichlit. But Dr. Rothschild had one more than just the ayin asichlit. One hospital he built for 10 years. The mental hospital, which is unique and different. 25 years ago, somebody who was depressed was considered a shoyte. Potum in a mitzvah. Not obligated in any mitzvah. Today, though, it is not a busha to be in the hospital. He's chayv in the mitzvah. We realize that it is a sickness like any other sickness. And this is what Dr. Rothschild has mechadesh, echidush in Bnei Brak. Let's hope that the community in Los Angeles will support this mental hospital like any other communities in the world. Thank you very much.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Chaim Fachler. I am the executive director of Maina Yeshua in Bnei Brak. It is my privilege and honor to introduce the guest speaker this evening, Professor Rael Strauss. He is the medical director of the mental health facility in Maina Yeshua in Bnei Brak. He is Durban born and educated, is a marathon runner. He sits on various committees in Israel on the ethics committee and other things. He's an amazing, amazing person, a close friend, and somebody you'll all enjoy listening to. Professor Strauss, please.
Thank you very much. It's a wonderful privilege and honor to be here. And I thank the organizers for making this all happen. A week ago, I was in Auschwitz. Now, many people go to Auschwitz. I was there as a representative of Israel, speaking, invited by the Polish government, at a medical conference on Auschwitz. As an incentive, they allowed the lecturers not just to go to Auschwitz, which many people do, but to enter Block 10. Now, in Block 10, I sat in the office in the rooms where Mengel and Klauberg did their experiments. But I decided not to think about those terrible cruelties and injustices that occurred in that building. But I thought rather about the doctors, the Jewish doctors that were there, that suffered unbearable suffering themselves, but were able to help others develop resilience. I thought about Dr. Seema Weisman, who as a gynecologist there, helped women before they went to the gas chambers to relax and to calm, and at least to feel some kind of serenity before their suffering. I thought about Dr. Louis Michaels, who used his powers to lie to Mengele and to falsify various documents and hide patients before Mengele came into the clinics, including in Block 10. I thought about Dr. Lena Bruder, who stood up to the SS and was even respected by the SS for what she did. The doctors mainly were involved with caring and comforting because they had no other way to help people. Dr. Rosenzweig in Auschwitz said, we cured many with good words, sitting to patients and helping them, listening to their problems. And then Dr. Giselle Pearl, who worked in New York after the war, who said, I will remain a human being to the last minutes of my life, whenever that will come. So these doctors were faced with a situation where they could not change what they were presented in their lives, but they could change how they dealt with that, and they could change the reality that they were faced with for themselves and for others that they could help. And that's what Viktor Frankl said, a psychiatrist who went through Auschwitz himself. When we no longer can and able to change the situation, we are challenged to change ourselves. And that's the essence of really what mental health professionals are trying to do. Sometimes we cannot change reality, what happens to us, but we can change how we deal with what happens to us. So living a life of meaning in the face of adversity encourages one to get above that transcendence to something above the challenges one is faced with. So the essence of resilience in dealing with what sometimes the challenges we have in life is not the what, but the how. Not what was accomplished, but how life is lived. And that's sometimes what we have to work towards. So Viktor Frankl, going through the camps that he did, he said, those that were able to persevere and to develop resilience found some kind of meaning in life. And that meaning could be whatever. Could be religion, could be seeing the family, could be helping others, some kind of meaning. So we know that religion for him was not necessarily primary in his life, even though after he died, his wife said that he put on tefillin every morning. But for him, he saw that those with religion used it to find some kind of meaning. So meaning, when it comes to mental illness, is not such a simple thing. And we need to understand what that is about. So working in a mental health institution where we primarily deal with religious patients or Jewish patients who are using some kind of tradition in their life, we have to understand sometimes where's the boundary between piety and pathology. And we'll discuss it just for a few minutes, what that means. So religion is very much ingrained in our civilization. What's the problem? 95% of the population believe in God, and about 80% of people maintain that religious beliefs are important to them. But only about 40% of mental health professionals believe in God and think that that's important. So in the mental health profession, religious beliefs are okay, but not religious experience. So how do we bring that in? How do we as mental health professionals who straddle both worlds deal with this potential conflict? So religion is important in people's life, but sometimes we have to make a decision. What is delusional? What is not? What is obsessive? What is not? This is not always so easy. So how do we approach religion? How do we understand it? So in science, we want to see what is the source of faith in the brain. If we look at a biological level, those who are looking from the scientific world, so what it is where it is what becomes important. So whether or not God exists is something that's a very personal thing, but how do we understand that maybe this can be hardwired at some level in the brain? So we know that religion essentially represents some kind of extension of extra personal space. I want to get above me. I want to transcend where I am. The question is, where does this happen at the brain? So nowhere through research, essentially there are four ways to approach where this is in the brain. Where does religion, where does belief exist? Where does spirituality in the brain? And researchers looked at experiences from hallucinogens, near-death experiences, dementias, epilepsy. We don't really have time to go into this. But there are various parts of the brain that we can look at when people experience these different kind of exposures. For example, sometimes people, when they get demented, they have excessive religion because of certain areas of the brain that degenerate. And we call that hippocampal sclerosis. And then their research is done with people experiencing spirituality. They've taken Buddhist monks, put them in an MRI, functional MRI, ask them to meditate. And when they meditate and they reach that epiphany that all of us are supposed to reach at Ni'ilah, at the end of Yom Kippur or Good Davening, and they push on a button, we can see exactly what area of their brain is experiencing that level of spirituality. One would think you need to tie them down and give them a helmet so they levitate and don't hit their heads, but that doesn't necessarily exist. But we can tell exactly the area of the brain that deals with spirituality. And essentially, it's a deactivation, it's a cutting off of posterior parietal lobe for anyone in the medical field who's present who wants to understand exactly how that works. But essentially, one area of the brain is cut off, another one becomes accentuated, the frontal lobe, whereas the parietal lobe, the area of the brain gets cut off, and that leads to spirituality. So what does it mean? How do I understand that as a religious person in the field of psychiatry? Does that mean that all religious experience is just artificial? Just one area of the brain that's just been accentuated? And let me ask you this question. Where did all the great revelations of all religions, where do they all occur? Every religion, Christianity, Buddhism, Islam, Judaism, where have all the great revelations occurred? on mountains, all of them. So what does it mean? We know that people who are exposed to high altitudes experience what they call otoscopy, where they see lights, they have these kind of religious experiences sometimes. Pilots, astronauts have experienced. Does that mean, when I think it's related to hypoxia, low oxygen in certain areas of the brain, does that mean that religious experience, just like we've seen in the brain, and religious experiences on mountains and altitude, religion is just, that's all it is, just a physical thing? It's not real? So the idea that something happens in a brain says that maybe sometimes I can experience that without divine intervention. And therefore some people use drugs to encourage spirituality. But I say something else. I say, isn't it incredible that the Kodesh Baruch Hu, or that higher force up there, has given us an ability to communicate with him and put an ear of the brain for us exactly to do that? But I need to tap into that. I need to tap into that. So Einstein said it would be possible to describe everything scientifically, but it would make sense without meaning, as if you described a Beethoven symphony as a variation of wave pressure. So working in a religious institution, or religious institution that we accept everyone, obviously, but we gear towards a religious individual, I have to understand when someone comes, really where they're coming from, and that's a sensitivity to the person's culture. And that's our building. So, as you know, when I work in the emergency room, we have a seven-story hospital, including inpatient, outpatient. We have an emergency room. How do I know when someone comes into the emergency room who says he's a Mashiach, then I'm not really admitting the Mashiach? How do I know where the person really is? How do I know when someone comes in and someone brings him in and say he's saying to the Mashiach, because it happens almost every day, that I'm not really admitting the Mashiach? Because we believe that's going to happen. Because you also have these kind of guys, David Koresh, Jonestown, Shangrinko, who these people have also said that they're the Mashiach or the Messiah in these foreign cultures and have done some very terrible things. How do I know the difference? So the aim of medical professionals is to identify states that are pathological so I can treat them, that I can deal with it. So OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder, is a fascinating example of this. If I don't understand where a person is coming from, I can really make mistakes. So if you don't understand where the person's got an issue with netilat yadayim, washing his hands, and they're washing, so maybe that's a normal thing. What about hichot nida? Hichas nida, if you don't understand where someone is coming from, that sounds very psychotic. And you can make a mistake. And we try to have professionals who can understand. And I give a classic example of a real story that happened a few months ago. Someone is staying in his apartment for a year and a half, won't leave his apartment. Why? He was a Talmid Mufak, the top student in a very prominent yeshiva in Israel. He never left his apartment for a year and a half. Why is that? Because he felt that every time he went to the street, he was married to every woman who saw him. So he's married to thousands of women. He wouldn't leave his apartment. So he was brought to all the top doctors in Israel, the top professors they called in Israel, they called them big doctors. And he was treated with antipsychotic medication. That sounds completely psychotic. You go to the street, you're married to thousands of women. How could that be? That's psychotic. That's a delusion. That's a problem with reality orientation, reality functioning. So he's treated with antipsychotics, and he just got worse and worse and worse. He was brought to us, and we sit there, and we said, what is the story? So he tells us he was learning the second and third Perek chapter from Masechet Kiddushin, where you learn the laws of marrying a woman. And we know that you can marry a woman with anything that's shaveh pruta, that has the worth of a pruta. And we use a ring today, but I can marry anyone. I can marry a woman with my watch. So he thought he was a very good-looking guy, and every time he went to the street, women would pay as if a shaveh pruta to see his face, and therefore he was considered safek, as in a case of doubt, married to these thousands of women, and therefore he never left his apartment. Now he knew it was irrational, and it really bothered him. That is not psychosis. That's obsessive compulsive disorder. You stop all the antipsychotic medication that's making worse. You put him on anti-obsessive medication. Within a month, he's back to full function. That's the kind of case. If you're not sensitive to where the person's come from, you can make mistakes. So that's the blind leading the blind. And we don't want to be in that situation. So the point of decision is the clinician must decide what is going on here. And sometimes when it comes to psychosis, when a person's out of touch with reality, when they have a religious belief, how do I know this is a true religious experience or this is psychosis? So we focus on the degree of conviction and the degree to which something is out of context with the person's culture. And that's critical. That's very important. So we focus on conviction, the preoccupation, and how much it causes the person distress. And we call that the dimensional approach. So, so differentiating between something that's psychotic and something that's really just a cultural or obsessive thing is in the capacity of the individual to return to reality of the experience, after the experience. So if in the Ilah, on Yom Kippur, I'm having this epiphany of connection with the Kodesh Baruch Hu, with God up there, I'm able to come out of that afterwards. I'm not staying on that level and I'm not stopping or functioning. That is a critical thing. So we know in the Haredi population that psychotic episodes are more intense than normative religious experiences, and psychosis is terrifying, and the deterioration of social skills and functioning, because that's critical. How do you define mental illness? A few years ago, I was asked to teach research to psychiatry residents. I said, let's do some research. So we went to a group of 300 psychiatrists who were meeting in a meeting in Israel, and we gave them a list of 30 diagnoses. DSM, the Bible of Psychiatric Diagnoses, only 30 diagnoses. So we asked the psychiatrists to self-diagnose themselves from 0 to 5. 0 non-exist, 5 very serious. What percentage of psychiatrists would you say admitted to suffer from some form of psychiatric illness? What percentage would you say? 5%? 10%? 100 would agree that they themselves suffered from some kind of mental disorder? 10%? 15%? Well, let me tell you, 89% of the psychiatrists wrote that they had suffered from some form of psychiatric disorder. I'm one of the 11% that's completely okay, but 89% wrote that they, but not 5, 2, 3. That's part of the human condition. All of us suffer from a bit of depression, obsession, some personality, eating, sexual. It's part of the human condition. The question is, does it affect function? And that's a critical thing that you have to look at here. And the place of doubt. Am I able to say, you know what, with my religious experience, it's important for me, it works for me, but I'm willing to consider that maybe that's not the only thing. You know, 86% of people believe in God, but 82% of these people believe that maybe there's another way. It's not just my way. So faith is only possible when doubt is present. Faith represents the triumph of reason over doubt. But this often requires teamwork, and that's why we work a lot with Rabbanim. And often when it comes to obsessive disorder, we bring in Rabbanim to help people understand, a bit of reality testing. So which cat just finished Yom Kippur davening? So you have to understand where the person's coming from. You have to understand the culture. So you're hearing visions and hearing voices, I'd say you're either really, really mad or really, really religious. We have to understand it. But religion is not a bad thing. Let me just tell you about epidemiological medicine's best kept secret. Evidence from 1,200 outcome studies and various research reviews, of the 13 factors that we look at in terms of health, religious belief is considered to be more beneficial than just about anything else. Do you know the difference between someone who's religious and someone who's not religious in terms of general health and mental health? Is the difference between someone who's been smoking a pack of cigarettes for 40 years and someone that's not? We don't really know why. Sometimes, some of the doctors, Hadassah, who did some of these studies, said, oh, because, you know, religious people eat fish, gefilte fish on Shabbat, or maybe that's good for them. Some say, oh, because religious people drive one day less or use less drugs. We don't really know, but there's something about religion that's actually protective in terms of general medicine. An active community support is also very important when it comes to general medicine, but not when it comes to psychiatry and mental health, and that's what I want to talk about for a few minutes. So just in summary, abnormality is defined not just by dimensions of religious experience, but by the degree that this experience deviates from conventional religious beliefs. So when it comes to mental health, the person who's suffering from mental health feels very alone. They're different. And that's the inner screen that Edward Munch talks about, that and depicts in this picture, that the person feels alone. And we as a community have to be sensitive to that. 1 in 4 adults suffer from mental illness in some time in any kind of year. They say that 2/3 of people in some point in their lives will have some kind of psychiatric illness, and only 1/3 of them will get treatment. It's not like that in general medicine. Just a few figures here for us in America. Approximately 1 in 25 adults, close to 10 million, experience serious mental illness in any year that significantly affects their function. 1 in 5 youth, 20%. About 7% of adults in America have had at least one major depressive episode, or had it in the past year. And about 20% have some kind of anxiety disorder. What about suicide? Suicide is the 10th leading cause of death in the United States, the 3rd leading cause of death for people, young people, and 2nd leading cause of death from ages 15 to 24. In Israel, one person dies a day by car accidents. And it hits the front page. Every day there's one person. About 360 people a year die by car accidents. It's a big deal. And it hits, and the name is there in the newspaper. Double that amount die from suicide in Israel, but no one talks about it. And millions of shekels the government invests in preventing car accidents. Nothing against suicide because of the stigma. We don't talk about it. Secret. More than 90% of children who die by suicide have a mental health condition. Each day in America, 18 to 22 people die from suicide. So 42% of people with a mental illness face stigma at least once a month and some kind of discrimination. 58% of them say that the stigma is difficult, even more difficult to deal with the illness itself. And about 2/3 of us know someone who have mental illness. So why stigma? Why is not dealing with people? And why is discrimination, or not talking about it and putting these people aside, why is it so damaging? First of all, because of stigma, people don't seek help and they suffer in silence. They don't get the treatment. It limits access to healthcare, housing, employment, diminishes self-esteem, and sometimes can even exacerbate depression. And it affects relationships for sure, at times it is most important. The United States Surgeon General labeled stigma as probably the biggest barrier to mental health care. And that's what we call stigma causes social distancing. I put the person out. They're not here, they're not with me. But it has to be a top public priority. And we don't deal with that. We don't talk about it. Mental health illness is considered now by the World Health Organization the biggest economic burden of any health issue in the world. But no one invests in that. And definitely not in the hospitals. 2/3 of costs are attributed to disability and loss of worth. But the majority of people don't receive care that they're supposed to receive. And the majority of people in this world hold negative attitudes to those with mental illness. We don't deal with them. You know, even our children talk about people as crazy and weird. That's the way that I want to talk something bad about someone, I call them crazy and weird. Mushuga. But that's a stigma. That's putting a name on someone. And also dangerous. Mentally ill people are dangerous. More mentally ill people are killed by others than those who are mentally ill kill others. In other words, more people with schizophrenia are killed by normal people without psychiatric illness than people with schizophrenia kill others. And then this is also related to self-stigma. And then people think, why do I need to try? Because everyone else is putting me on the side, and that becomes an important barrier to receiving care. And that do not continue sometimes with the medication. And because of the stigma, we often don't screen for mental health illness. And people suffer in silence. It doesn't have to be like that. And what about the cost of mental health disorders compared to the funding? You know, I come from a country where the hospitals look like hotels. You go into Hadassah, Ichilov, Tel HaShomer, every toilet seat has like this plaque that's donated by someone from America or England, a little bit from South Africa. But you come to a psychiatric hospital, nothing. I worked for 20 years in a Ministry of Health hospital. No one ever invested in the hospital, nothing. And that's why the psychiatric hospitals are put out on the side, and there's 6 to 10 per room, one shower for 30, 40 patients, always someone being restrained because they don't invest in the staff. And that's why there's criminalization of people with mental illness. And this is fascinating. Most adults with and without mental health disorders believe that treatment can help people with mental health. 57% of adults believe that they're actually helping and are sensitive to mentally ill, but only about a quarter of mentally ill believe that people are being sensitive to them. So therefore, people feel alone. And it shouldn't happen in the community, and it shouldn't happen in our Jewish community. We're supposed to be sensitive to the weak. And this is maybe the last figure I'll tell you, that research found that 68% of Americans do not want someone with mental illness marrying into their family. Think about that. Would you want that? When you talk about shidduchim, that's the first thing people look at. But we all have it in our family. And 58% do not want people with mental illness in their workplaces. How many of you would be comfortable with having a hostel with people with mental illness opening up next door to where you live? Let me ask you this question. How many of you have ever visited someone in a hospital with pneumonia, heart disease, broken bones? Most people have done bikkur cholim. But if I had to ask you, how many of you have ever visited someone in a psychiatry hospital who's not a member of your family? Almost no one. It's extremely rare. But why is that? It doesn't have to be like that. I ask you this. How many of you have ever visited a psychiatry ward in this place? This is Cedar Sinai, where we're standing right now. How many of you have ever visited someone in a psychiatry ward or in the outpatient department? None of you, because it doesn't exist. They closed it down because it costs a lot of money. And that's true. Psychiatry costs money. It's not profitable. And therefore, services are closing down and people are not getting what they needed. So therefore, what we did in Bnei Brak was a paradigm shift in psychiatry, because we felt as a hospital that's treating the community, we need to look after the weakest. And the weakest within medicine are those with mentally ill. And just because someone has mental illness doesn't mean they need to be treated in a place where there are 10 people per room and one shower for 40 patients, like what happens in many psychiatry hospitals. And why should someone with mental illness be treated in a place and not get the same level of treatment in terms of conditions, at least physical conditions, like someone getting for treatment for pneumonia? And therefore, and you, if you look in where we open our hospital, this looks like a lobby of a hotel. But it's a psychiatry hospital. And that's what a room looks like, two per room. Each have their own bathroom and suite. And that's the place where patients spend time during the day. We don't have time to go more into details about that. You know, this for me is a very important picture. This is a real picture. Let me ask you, you know, where I don't know what it's like here, but I know what it's like in Israel. You know, in Israel, you go into a hospital, you can buy Coke from a machine. You put your money and get a Coke. But now in Israel, I notice now in the hospitals, you go into the hospital, you put money in, and you can even get flowers. You bring flowers to a patient. I've been in psychiatry for 25 years. I've been in psychiatry for 25 years. I have never, ever seen anyone bring flowers to someone in a psychiatry ward. Why is that? And I've been speaking about that for the last year in different forums in Israel, and I still have not seen it. This is a picture I took 2 days before Pesach this year, about a month ago. I'm on the women's ward. We have a women's ward that's constantly full. All our wards are constantly full. There's a great need. There's a fight every day for beds. I come in the ward and I see one of the patients there with postpartum psychosis holding flowers on her hand. I said, voila, at last, after 25 years in psychiatry, someone has brought her flowers. I go in to say, this is incredible. Someone brought you flowers. She said, no. I've been in the hospital now for 2 weeks. And Pesach is coming tomorrow. And I went out and I bought myself some flowers. So what can be done? Increased awareness. That's what we're doing tonight. I'm preaching to the converted. Education and support to manage bias. More screening for mental illness. It is preventable. And so doing so will drastically reduce suffering and disability. So once again, the patient sitting in front of me is most important. I need to step outside of me and be where that patient is. This is an ethical obligation that has come out from the horrors of the Nazi medicine. It's a special and direct outgrowth. Let me ask you about this patient, this picture. Does anyone know where this is? Does anyone know where this is? Where's this? That's Treblinka. Treblinka has a very, very special place for medicine. Everyone talks about medicine and the horrors of medicine in the Nazi world, and we just had Yom HaShoah, so it's foremost on our mind right now. Everyone talks about Auschwitz and Mengele. Mengele was relatively small fish. He was a bad man. He did some terrible things. But this guy is really what we should be talking about, because he was the only concentration camp or death camp commander who was a doctor. But very few of you probably know his name. And he was considered to be the most successful camp commander of all time during the Nazi era. His name was Dr. Imfried Erbil. He was a doctor. And he set up Treblinka. And he killed 280,000 Jews in 6 weeks. No one came even close to that. Not in the peak function of Auschwitz. No one came close to those numbers. How did he manage to do it? Dr. Imfried Erbil had already headed two psychiatry hospitals, Bernburg and Brandenburg in Germany, where they gassed mentally ill patients. He was a psychiatrist. He worked in psychiatry. And he knew the way to get people into gas chambers to trust the doctor. So he used to walk around with a white coat because people trusted the doctor. And that's how he managed to get so many Jews into that gas chamber from his experience with mentally ill. But when you go to Yad Vashem and you say, what happened to the mentally ill, the Jews? No, in Yad Vashem, every city in the world that respects himself has a Holocaust museum. But what about the mentally ill? It all began with them. And when I go to Yad Vashem and I look at what happened to mentally ill, we deal with the Jews, not the mentally ill. And there's a little poster in the exhibition that talks about the mentally ill. But what happened to the Jewish mentally ill? No, they died like everybody else. That's not true. It started with the Jewish mentally ill. And they suffered. They were the doubly cursed. But we don't talk about the Jewish mentally ill. The Polish and the Germans talk about the mentally ill because we also suffered. But why don't we talk about the Jewish mentally ill? We'd all started with them and they suffered doubly because of the stigma. We don't talk about the mentally ill because they don't have a voice. And that's why many of the conditions in the hospital, and that's why we don't talk about what happened to the Jewish mentally ill in the Holocaust, even though they suffered doubly more than anybody else. Elie Wiesel said in the final analysis, I believe in man in spite of man. And this is what he said. When I think about the Nazi doctors, the medical executioners, I lose hope. To find it again, I think about the others, the victim doctors. I see again their burning gazes, their ashen faces. Am I naive in believing that medicine is still a noble profession, upholding the highest ethical principles? For the ill, doctors still stand for life. And for us all, hope. We just finished, or we're in the period now, of Sfirat HaOmer. And there's a progression here, from Pesach to Yom HaShoah, Yom HaZikaron, Yom HaTzmut, and then Shavuot. From the suffering coming out of slavery to receiving the Torah. And then Yom HaShoah, Yom HaZikaron, the very intense, powerful period in Israel. Some have called it Aseret Yemei HaUmah. But then the question is, what about Lag BaOmer? Where does Lag BaOmer fit into it? It doesn't kind of fit, right? Because we're talking about the national process from slavery to the heights of receiving the Torah. So where does Lag BaOmer fit in? So Lag BaOmer fits in an extremely important place, because Lag BaOmer is about Ben Adam LeChavero. We can't have a nation and reach the heights that we want to get to if we don't talk about and we're not sensitive and we don't preserve dignity and hope of our fellow man. And on the path to nationhood and to the hearts that we want to go through with our community, we have to be sensitive to those around us, especially the weak. So Viktor Frankl said, in a situation that I have no control, we can control ourselves. But it goes even beyond that. Between stimulus and response is a space, and that space is our power to choose our response. And our response lies our growth and freedom. That's where we have control. I can choose how I act and how we act as a community towards the weak. And I'll end off by saying this. It was Gandhi's words. He said, the greatness of a nation and its moral progress can be judged by the way its weak are treated. And the weak in medicine are the mentally ill, because they don't have a voice. And that's our challenge. To be that voice for them, to be sensitive to them, to reach out for them, and to make treatment, support, and comfort accessible to all. I thank you.
Okay, at this point, for the concluding half of our session tonight, I'd like to call upon our expert panel to please join the stage. And as they make their way up to the panel, if we are going to heed Professor Strauss's call, I mean, if you just take a look around, the turnout tonight is really an important reminder about how many people showed up for this topic, about how urgent it is that we address these issues. And so we turn now to some of our local community leaders. And I will just say, you know, we wanted to have four because we don't have all night, but, you know, we all know that there is a number of people, even in this room here tonight, who are true experts and leaders on the front lines in our community. We wish we could have had all of you. What I'll do is I'll introduce each one. They'll each take about 5 minutes to deliver remarks. I'll walk through the room once or twice as they're speaking. If anyone has specific questions, just raise your hand to me. Either hand to me either the paper you've already written or take one from me to write questions, and I'll take them from you and we'll pose those questions after all four of them make their remarks. I'll introduce them now. I guess we'll just go in order from closest to me. We'll just go from left to right here. I guess closest to my name and then further away. We'll do it that way. So the first one, closest to me here, is Rabbi Dr. Zev Wiener. Rabbi Dr. Zev Wiener received his MD degree from Harvard Medical School and rabbinical ordination from Yeshiva University. He completed his residency in psychiatry at UCLA's Semel Institute for Neuroscience, where he served as chief resident of the Resnick Neuropsychiatric Hospital at UCLA. He presently serves as an attending psychiatrist at UCLA Medical Center, runs a private practice in psychiatry, and teaches Torah on the staff of Young Israel Century City and Eula Boys High School. After Rabbi Dr. Wiener, we will have Rabbi Avraham Union. Rabbi Union is the rabbinic administrator of the Rabbinical Council of California, the RCC, and serves as the dayan and menahal of its beis din, with responsibilities for dinei Torah, financial arbitration, conversion, and gittin. He studied at the Tel Yeshiva in Chicago, followed by 8 years at Yeshiva Space HaTalmud in Yerushalayim, where he received a smicha in both Yore Yore and Yadin Yadin. He also holds a master's degree in psychology from Pepperdine University. Rabbi Union founded Or Sameach's branch in South Africa, Johannesburg, in 1981, where he did undergraduate work in psychology at the University of South Africa. He later served as rabbi of Cape Town's Constantia congregation and was appointed as dayan for the Cape Din Beis Din. Rabbi Union's professional interests include mental health issues in the Orthodox community, particularly regarding abuse and maladaptive behavior. He has authored or collaborated on several research studies of Orthodox conversion and presented the results at national conferences. He also published numerous articles in journals devoted to Jewish financial law. After Rabbi Union, we have Shelley Leibovitz, LCSW. Shelley Leibovitz is a well-known psychotherapist in private practice in Beverly Hills, who for 30 years has been treating individuals, couples, and families with great success. She specializes in relationship issues and offers coaching for those struggling with the shidduch journey. She has an extremely popular book out called The Diamond for Your Daughter, a guide for parents navigating the dating process, published by Judaica Press. And furthest down the panel, we have Mrs. Debbie Fox, LCSW. She is the founder and creator of the internationally recognized Safety Kid program. Mrs. Fox has facilitated a unique partnership between schools, families, and children to create a safer world for our community's youngest members. At home, school, and at camp, guided by her passion for keeping children safe, she established Magen Yeladim Child Safety Institute in 2013 and currently serves as its director, consulting throughout the world on abuse, prevention, and intervention. A licensed social worker, Debbie also lectures frequently and has published within her area of expertise and most recently authored Seminary Savvy, Every Girl's Guide to a Successful, Safe, and Satisfying Experience in Seminary and Beyond. Her work as a consultant has been utilized by county and state agencies in the areas of child, family, and cross-cultural sensitivity training, for which she has received letters of honor and recognition. We'll start here with Rabbi Dr. Wiener.
Thank you, Rabbi Wiener. Good evening. I was asked to speak this evening about the treatment of schizophrenia, bipolar, suicidal behaviors, and OCD. And to talk about that in any meaningful way is like fitting a whale into a little fish tank in 5 minutes. But I wouldn't even have time to really get into what those conditions mean. Let's just assume for those who are not familiar that they are very, very, can be very significant and impairing mental health conditions. And the major thing that I think is important for us to take away this evening, when it comes to issues like schizophrenia, bipolar, obsessive compulsive, is that Bechasdei Hashem, with the kindness of God, the life outcomes, the expectations of people struggling with these conditions have improved a great deal over the years. And in the past, someone who was diagnosed with one of these diagnoses could never expect to live independently, could never expect to get married, to hold a job. It was often an automatic institutionalization for life. And nowadays, things are vastly different, right? There are plenty of people who carry these diagnoses and go on to accomplish tremendous things in their life, certainly in terms of independent living, marriage, family, jobs. And in terms of the reason for these improvements, so some of it certainly seems to have to do with improved medical treatments. The medications available today, even in the past number of years, are vastly superior for the most part in terms of tolerability to older medications that were around. They certainly leave a lot to be desired, unfortunately, but there's constant progress and there's constant work. And it's important to know that things can continue to get better for people with these diagnoses. But what I wanted to just highlight very briefly this evening are the improvements in awareness of the non-medical aspects, the non-pharmacological things, which can greatly improve outcomes in any one of these diagnoses. And the one that I wanted to highlight this evening, which is perhaps most relevant for us here as a community, is exactly that, the notion of being in a community, the impact that community living can have on a person's recovery. I'd just like to give a few brief examples of this, and I will close. It's not uncommon to have someone who suffers from a severe illness, as Professor Strauss alluded to beautifully earlier, who isolates, right? They feel dehumanized, they feel nobody cares about them, they don't leave their home for months, sometimes even longer. And I have seen firsthand how marshaling people in the community to invite someone, for example, for Friday night to dinner, literally pulls a person out of their depression. Now, I wish it was that simple to treat the condition, and not just depression, any sort of one of these severe illnesses. And obviously, that's not an ultimate fix, but it's a catalyst. It can often be the first step towards the person thawing out of that freeze that they've had that's engulfed their life to such an extent. And you know, being part of a community, being able to be invited out by the right family, right, it has to be a kind, sensitive family, can do tremendous things that someone who lives on his or her own can never dream to accomplish. Sometimes in severe illnesses, people will lose their insight, meaning they begin to not recognize that they are suffering. Everyone around them sees that they're not in their normal state of mind, but they lose the capacity to do that and to seek help. And oftentimes, even the family, through its best efforts to try to convince someone, are unsuccessful of doing this. I've seen in numerous occasions how having a close community contact, someone who a person has known for many years, they trust, they're not part of their family, can make the difference in those critical moments, in a standoff where we're in, where they'll decide to pursue treatment rather than go against it. They don't listen to their parents, but they listen to that person they respect in the community. Again, that's a tremendous asset that we have to be leveraging in the war against mental illness. I know at Sadiq, who anytime he's in this community, anytime he hears of a person who's struggling with a mental health issue, he takes them out to breakfast, literally to the local breakfast place. He's not part of an organization, he has no agenda, and it's just to give them chizuk. He's not a professional, he just says, I care about you. That's part of being in a community, and that also, having spoken to people in that position, has had a big impact on recovery in these severe conditions, potentially severe conditions. And finally, there's numerous people in this community who offer jobs to people who are recently recovered from these mental health struggles. Somebody who recently had a break, was hospitalized, more and more data is showing the capacity of employment, of vocational rehabilitation. Giving someone work is not just about earning money. It's actually a form of healing, a form of treatment in many of these chronic conditions, but you need the right person to employ someone. Most employers are not sensitive to these needs to recognize that they may not be ready for all the stress that can come. And again, we have tzaddikim like this in our community, and we need more. We need more people to step up to fill this important role. So just to finally conclude, while we talk about removing stigma and eliminating stigma from our community, reducing it, certainly important, but that, I think, is just the first step. That's removing a negative, so to speak. What we need to do is far more ambitious as well, and that is utilizing the community to introduce a positive, to leverage the potential benefits that you should have if you're living in a community like this that you would not have if you lived alone. Halavai, we should all step up to rise to the occasion, to meet the need, and we should know of no more suffering.
Where do the rabbis fit into the battlefront dealing with mental illness in the community? First, Rabbanim have the traditional role of a posek. Orthodox Jews live their lives according to halakha, according to Jewish law, from the moment we wake up until we retire, what we eat, how we dress, what we say, what we're not permitted to say. Everything falls within the confines of halakha, and this is true about health, and it's certainly true about mental health as well. Many questions come up, questions about therapy, questions about medication, questions about confidentiality, questions about shiduchim, questions about struggling with parents or family members, kibud av ve'em, and these are questions that we need to draw upon the knowledge of the Torah that the rabbi as a posek, as a halakhic authority, can offer. Second role of Rabbanim is support. I echo the words stated. We need to support anyone who's going through a challenge or a crisis of any sort. And mental health crises can be as painful and often more painful than challenges people are facing in other areas of health, parnasa, and life difficulties. Rabbanim can offer words of encouragement to the person who's suffering. They need to encourage the family who many times is trying to find the wherewithal to help a family member. They need to offer hope, because there is so much hope of what can be done to alleviate the suffering, to restore mental health, and bring people back to the place that we all want them to be in being productive members of Klal Yisrael. The third role of Rabbanim is as educators. A Rav, a Rabbi, a Rebbe is a teacher, and we need to teach. We need to teach the community about the stigmas attached to mental health. Really, I think our community has come so far in recent years. It's amazing how far we have come, but not far enough. We still have to bring to people the message that no one feels ashamed to consult a cardiologist if there's some palpitations. No one is ashamed to go to the dermatologist because they're embarrassed by their acne. Why should there be any embarrassment or shame about consulting a psychiatrist or going to a therapist to help with some of the problems that we may face in life? No young woman chooses to struggle with anorexia. No young man decides to be debilitated by depression. They're victims, like any other victim of some pain that's been inflicted upon them. And while we don't understand the hows and the whys, HaKadosh Baruch Hu sends nisyonos our way, every person's way. These people may have these nisyonos. Can we not find the wisdom and the understanding and the Torah that HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave us to teach us how to relate to all of them and give them that hope and support and encouragement to move forward? So these then are the three roles of Rabbanim. A, to serve as halakhic authorities and guides, which can give so much security for people who are not sure and unsure of themselves as how to proceed, to provide that guidance and clarity. B, to offer support to those afflicted, to those around them, to everyone who needs to face a challenge in some area of life. And C, to educate and bring to our community the values that Torah Seinu HaKadosha has given us, so that we can grow as a community, grow in our mental health, and be stronger, more productive, and more wonderful members of Klal Yisrael.
So I've been asked to speak about the topic of mental illness as it relates to shidduchim, which is a huge topic, needless to say, but I'm going to try to cover just a few points briefly. It's a topic that engenders a huge amount of worry and a huge amount of anxiety among people. particularly because lately we've seen an alarming rise in divorces among young couples. So we worry for our children, we worry for our grandchildren, we worry for ourselves if we're in this parsha. How would we know if somebody were perhaps anorexic? How would we know if somebody were suffering from depression or anxiety? How would we know if a young man perhaps had bipolar disorder, was prone to temper outbursts? The answer is we don't know, and we can't know, and some of these things are very, very, very difficult and, of course, very alarming. But that doesn't mean that there aren't things that we can do to somehow help ourselves with this challenge. What I thought I would do is just in a few short minutes dispel some common myths that come my way very, very often and that I think a lot of people subscribe to. One very common myth is, if I find out someone is struggling with a psychological condition of any sort, and I'm suggested as they're suggested to me as a shidduch, I must immediately move on and not even consider it. So that really is a myth, because as we've heard tonight, so many people struggle with things. There is a wide, wide spectrum when we talk about mental illness. It's not simple. And that spectrum reaches from very severe to very mild. So there's a tremendous, tremendous need to be aware that people with some kind of diagnosis might be perfectly able to live a happy life, a functional marriage, be a wonderful parent, and do very well. So one should not automatically assume that if they've heard something or suspect something, that that is immediate grounds for disqualifying someone. Each case is unique, each case is different, and each case should be looked at very, very carefully. Questions that one might look into are the person's history, are they in treatment, what kind of attitude do they have towards treatment, what kind of social history do they have, what kind of work history, et cetera, et cetera. There are a lot of ways to look into it and still see if the person being discussed is really someone that should still be considered. Myth number two that's also very common is that someone's history as an adolescent or even as a young adult will be a sure indicator of the kind of spouse they will make. So perhaps you've heard about a girl that was suggested to your son or grandson and you hear that she was very homesick and came home from seminary early. Perhaps you've heard that a young man had a very rebellious time in high school. Should these be grounds for dismissal? Absolutely not. Don't automatically assume that this says anything about the person. Look into it. Be careful before assuming that that's a deal breaker. Myth number three, which is really, really, really common. If there's mental illness in the extended family, run, don't walk. So we hear this a lot, that a third cousin suffered from postpartum depression, I don't want to touch this. That the mother has an aunt who maybe had schizophrenia at some point, no, not for me. Don't even talk to me about it. Now, again, there is a wide spectrum of these kinds of things. Some of them are very serious. My point to you is that it takes careful thought and discussion. Sometimes it's important to talk it over with a doctor, with someone knowledgeable, before automatically assuming that it's a deal breaker for your child. Myth number four, screening for mental illness is impossible. No one will tell me the truth anyway. The trouble with this whole topic is that people I find are very, very shy and awkward when they're screening for a shidduch. They don't feel comfortable asking pointed questions. They don't feel entitled to ask about a person's history. They feel like it's intrusive. They feel like it's just not appropriate. So yes, how will they find anything out? Part of what I do when I deal with things like this is try to encourage people to feel entitled to ask the right questions of the right people. There's no way to know anything if you don't feel entitled to asking. It has to be respectful, it has to be appropriate, it has to be gentle, but there's nothing wrong with asking someone a character reference and saying, is there anything about this particular individual that should give me cause for concern? Anything about their health or mental health that you feel I should know? And by asking a pointed question like that, you can look at reactions, you can look at hesitations, you can look at the answers you get and make an evaluated, intelligent decision about whether there should be some concern. And then the final myth I want to put forth is that people believe that individuals put their best foot forward on dates and my child will not notice any red flags anyway. And this, of course, perpetuates the cause for concern and really gets people very, very uptight. It's true that many times indicators are subtle, but in almost every single case of a marriage gone bad because of something like a psychological disorder, the partner of the person will admit that they saw subtle signs while dating. I was talking to one of my clients today, a young lady who's married about 20 years, 6 kids, married to a very, very serious alcoholic, and we were talking about her history with him, and she admitted that she had dated him for about 3 weeks, but she also admitted that she really did see signs, and when she got engaged, she was very, very worried about them, and she went ahead anyway. And in almost every case that I've seen like this, people will admit that they did see some subtle signs while dating. So what I tell people is you do have to have your child, or whether it's a grandchild, a child, yourself, talk over every date. Process it with someone, whether it's a parent or a Rebbe or a teacher or a coach or a mentor. Talk over each date and go through what happened and process the child's feelings about those dates and hear the details. It really, really is important. Otherwise, people can get swept up. I've had girls saying all kinds of things to me. One girl said to me, Mrs. Leibovitz, do you think it should be a problem for me that I was on a date last night and my date was kicking the billiard table when he got angry? And, you know, this girl was like completely clueless. Well, yes, of course that's a cause for concern. Tell me more. Another girl said, should I be concerned that my date lost his temper and started getting really, really mad and angry and took me home because he thought that I was distracted and not paying enough attention to him? Well, yes, that is cause for concern. Now, if kids don't have where to take these conversations, whether it's home or elsewhere, what are they going to do? So I can't overemphasize the value in speaking over the details with somebody, whoever that person might be. I'm going to take a 2-second station break and advertise my book that was mentioned in my intro, Diamond for Your Daughter, because in the book, which has been really, really popular, Baruch Hashem, we do, Emunah Braverman, my co-author, and I really do talk about red flags, mental illness, how to recognize things, signs that are subtle that kids can see on dates, and how to handle those. So it's a worthwhile read if this is a topic that concerns you. Before closing, I do want to add that there are 2 common myths on the other side of the equation for people who do struggle with psychological challenges. They too adhere to certain myths. One is, well, marriage will cure me. Marriage will solve my problems. Marriage will be the end of my struggle. And that, of course, we know is a terrible, terrible myth. Marriage is not a car wash. It really is best and vital that people struggling with any level of psychological challenge address it and treat it. And Baruch Hashem, most of these conditions are very treatable, that they treat it before starting to date and go into dating feeling healthy and feeling whole. The second myth that we see a lot of on this side of the equation is that I will not disclose anything when I'm dating someone. I'll keep it hidden at all costs. And most of us are aware of how detrimental and really, really tragic that kind of thinking can be. So that is a terribly damaging myth. It's important that people understand when to disclose, how to disclose, speak to a Rav about that, handle it with the utmost of caution, but don't try to pull the wool over anyone because it comes back to bite very, very severely. I did have a very interesting case of a young lady, a wonderfully high-functioning young lady who came in to see me because she had OCD. And she was of the age where her friends were getting engaged and she was expected to start dating. She had no interest in dating, and after 2-3 years of just rejecting all the dates that were brought to her, she said, I'd better go get some therapy. And she did, and she treated the OCD, and when it came time to taking a shidduch, she actually did. She met a wonderful young man, struggled with what to tell him and when, got advice from a rav and followed his advice, and with a lot of support and help, was coached as to how to break the news to her by then serious suitor. And to her shock, he was so supportive, so impressed, so respectful of how she told him, of how she had endured this challenge and treated it. And they're happily married. So these are not fairy tales, these are true stories. And I say this to encourage people to accept people with a diagnosis, understand that it doesn't mean they're horrible or unmarriageable or anything like that, again, depending on the specifics of each case, and to handle each situation with a great deal of thought and a great deal of common sense. Thank you.
Okay. I think I'd like to begin with a personal definition of stigma that was quoted in the Cambridge University Press. It seemed very powerful. For me, stigma means fear, resulting in a lack of confidence. Stigma is loss, resulting in unresolved mourning issues. Stigma is not having access to resources. Stigma is being invisible or reviled, resulting in conflict. Stigma is lowered family esteem and intense shame, resulting in decreased self-worth. Stigma is secrecy. Stigma is anger, resulting in distance. Most importantly, stigma is hopelessness, resulting in helplessness. And what is the natural response to private and public stigma and shame? It's secrecy. And in fact, family and friends may endure a stigma by association that they suffer with. It's called courtesy stigma. And mental illness isn't considered merely a personal failure, but it also disgraces the family. These beliefs, this stigma, deeply affects every member of the family. In one study of 156 parents and spouses of first admission patients, half reported making efforts to conceal and hide the psychiatric illness in themselves as well as in their family members. So unlike physical illness, when patients kept mental health issues a secret, they have less access to treatment, less access to resources, and they have a very insular network that they live in. Those suffering with mental illness describe that they often have as hard a time combating the stigma as they do coping with the effects of the illness itself. So what can we do? We're talking about stigma and shame here in this room and how deeply it affects people within our own community. How can we use tonight to empower ourselves, each one of us, to make a difference? So I want to tell you a quick story. Several years ago, my husband and I were on a long night flight, and we had great seats, the seats in front where we didn't have a seat in front of us, lots of leg room, no one in between us. And we thought, oh, this is going to be good. We're going to get to sleep tonight. And we were both so exhausted that we actually fell asleep before the flight even left. Well, that didn't last long because very soon after we sat down, someone in back of us was sitting down and we both felt kicking and we heard very loud noises and we both woke up before the flight even left. And we turn around and look behind us and there's a couple with about a 5-year-old boy. And the 5-year-old boy is kicking against the seat, and the parents are looking at us. And We both looked at each other and said, this is going to be one long flight. And then, before the flight even left, the woman gets up. She comes in front and she says, my name is, and she tells us her name. She said, my son is 5 and he has autism. Let me talk to you about what's going to happen. This is what he's going to do, and this is how we're going to intervene. I hope you don't mind, but I'm going to give you a pamphlet on autism. Maybe this will help you to understand what's going on. Did we get a lot of sleep on that flight? No. Did we walk out of the flight with empathy and understanding? We did. She was a role model for how one can deal with mental illness. Research shows that increased awareness is probably one of the most important things that can be done to counteract stereotypes and to reduce stigma. And being honest, we've all been touched. If we're in this room, if we're part of our community, whether it's within our families, whether it's close friends, whether it's people we love, we've all been touched with some type of mental illness or special need. It's part of our community. What we have to do is to encourage families, encourage ourselves to feel that it's safe to come forward, that people can share situations and that family members may be suffering with, and we can feel accepted and understood by our neighbors and by our community. I have a relative whose first child was born with Down syndrome. The first Shabbos after her birth, they had a kiddush, and the new young father stood up and spoke very, very eloquently about his love for his newborn daughter who has Down syndrome. And he welcomed his daughter to his family and to the community with great pride. And until today, they are constantly educating others about how to be with their daughter without judgment. While preparing for this talk, a neighbor stopped me, and she was talking about how on Pesach, she recognized that everybody was asking about everybody else's adult children. Did yours come? How are yours doing? All these kinds of conversations. She has 2 children with mental illness. Nobody asked her how those children were. It was so hurtful to her. She said, if someone just acknowledged them, if someone just said, where are your children or how are they doing, it would have been so meaningful. Or even, I've been thinking about them, it would have been so meaningful. It's often said that it takes a village to raise a child, but it takes that same village to understand and make space for and raise a special needs child or people with mental illness. This is our village. This is our village. And we need to educate each other and our neighbors and our schools and our rabbis and our health professionals all about mental health related issues. We need to be aware of all the available resources that we have and even ones that we don't have right now. We need to utilize resources with pride and gratefulness that they exist. And we need to be able to share family members' successes and challenges, even when there's mental health related issues. We all need to celebrate each other's successes, and we need to help each other through challenges. Research has shown that the more education and awareness, the greater the understanding of individuals diagnosed with mental illness. And thus, there's a greater level of acceptance. Evenings such as this are critical to decreasing stigma. I started with research from Cambridge University, and I'm going to end with words from our own village. In Words Unspoken, this past week in Mishpacha magazine, a mother shared her feelings to a neighbor who dared to send her child to play in this woman's home, despite the fact that she had 2 off-the-derech children. And she writes, because of you, our journey is a bit easier. Because of you, we have a slice of normalcy in our Shabbos. And for that, may Hashem reward you tenfold. May you never know this pain. May all of your children succeed and thrive. I'm davening for you, neighbor, and maybe you're davening for me too. But one thing I know, you're an ally in this journey. And for that, I can never repay you. Hashem can, and I know he will. And I think that's how we can make a difference. We can all be allies in the journey with each other.
So we have about 10 minutes left. We received some very profound questions. I'm going to ask the ones that came up most frequently. Mrs. Fox, we actually received an email for someone who was a victim of childhood sexual abuse. And this person felt that they had suffered throughout their life because of the abuse that they endured, and that there were warning signs, but no one picked up on them. Can you help us understand what are some of the warning signs that people should be looking out for, or what can be done in the community to help people who feel that they're being ignored or not being sufficiently cared for?
It's a painful question. It really is. In terms of the piece about what are the warning signs, what one of the things that is most important and most painful for all of us to know, our expectation is always that sexual abuse occurs at the hands of a stranger. Over 90% of sexual abuse occurs at the hands of someone known, loved, and respected by the child, someone within our world. So it's extremely important to pay attention to our children's relationships with people within our world. That's what we need to be looking out for. I think that most important is to take a look at if there, well, I'd say most important to take a look at are our children's relationships with others. It's always painful for me to say that, and it's so true, the area of greatest concern within the Frum community is siblings. Is brothers and sisters, and relationships between brothers and sisters. And then it goes to cousins and to others that we know within our community. It's extremely important to pay attention to special relationships within our children. It's extremely important to have adequate supervision. Many people have many children, but we have to have adequate supervision both at home and to pay attention to what goes on not at home and any special relationships outside, even within the family, but any special relationships. That's something that really has to be looked out for, people grooming our children. It's something that we have to look out for. I think most importantly, when we see a child who possibly was doing well, was doing okay, they had a status quo, and all of a sudden we're seeing dramatic changes in that child, whether it be anxiety, whether it be crying, whether it be fears, whether it be fears of different people, any dramatic changes we see in a child need to be assessed.
Mrs. Leibovitz, we received some questions related to the impact of social media and technology, both on the dating process and on our youth. Any reflections on the impact of social media or technology?
I think that's sort of like a whole night's lecture in itself. You know, like what is there to say? There's so much to say, and yet there's nothing to say. We all know that the dangers of social media are too huge to even begin to enumerate. I don't think I'm adding anything by making that comment. And yeah, people just have to be extraordinarily careful. You know, today when somebody is suggested a shidduch, the first thing they do is Google the person. The second thing they do is go on Facebook and, you know, check out the picture. I think it is what it is, and I'm not sure that there's a way out of that or a way around that. But again, I can only underscore using common sense and being intelligent and going about things case by case, with caution and with proper direction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Rabbi Union, we received some questions from people who want to involve rabbis and seem to express some concerns about how do they know what's within the purview of a rabbi, if a rabbi has sufficient training, or what can a rabbi offer in particular, what are some of the resources that Judaism has to offer for people struggling for mental illness, and when to know at what point Should they be turning to their rabbi, or what point should they be turning to a mental health professional?
I'll answer you by telling the story. Years ago, there was a member in our community, a very fine person who was suddenly exhibiting some strange, uncharacteristic behavior. Bursts of anger, temperament. He was always a nice fellow, and suddenly wasn't being so nice. So who do we send him to? Do we send him to a rabbi? Give him a little mussar, teach him a little Torah, how to behave, to improve. Do we send him to a therapist? What's eating you up? What's going on inside? The answer is none of the above. He had to be sent to a neurosurgeon because it was a result of a brain tumor that our dear Professor Strauss could probably explain how that organically affected centers of behavior that resulted in this uncharacteristic behavior. My point is simply, we don't always know whether the problem is rabbinic in nature, whether it is a matter of therapy, or whether there's something underlying in medicine. You're not going to send someone battling anorexia to a rabbi who's not qualified to treat it. You're not going to send someone who's struggling with a Yetzer Hara to the psychiatrist to give them a pill to make them behave. And you're not necessarily going to send someone to a therapist when it's not really a therapeutic process that they need to undergo. It's not always clear exactly what the person needs. But it's certainly clear that we can explore when we have a problem and we feel that that problem is something that requires rabbinic input, then you want to look for a resource that you feel is helpful. Not every doctor is a neurosurgeon. Not every therapist is an expert in every area of therapy. So you will want to look for a rabbanim. The first thing you want to find is someone, do you feel the person cares and empathizes and understands what you're saying? And if you have someone that you feel can understand your problem, then you're halfway there. And then hopefully, you'll get to the Rav, and if he feels that it's beyond his ability to help that person through the struggle that they're having, he'll know how to put them in touch with those who can.
Thank you. Rabbi Dr. Wiener, we received a number of questions. We heard a lot about individuals struggling with mental illness. What resources are there? What suggestions do you have for the families of those who are struggling with mental illness?
It's an important question. Obviously, every situation is unique. You know, mental illness, a term that we use this evening, is such a broad term, you know, ranging from one extreme to the other in terms of how you would approach it. But a couple of just sort of general rules of thumb that come to mind. Perhaps one has to distinguish between emergent and non-emergent resources and interventions, right? Sometimes, God forbid, there may be an imminent crisis where you don't have time to be looking around for help. You have to do something right away, right? This would include if there are concerns of suicidality, for example, acute psychosis, violence. In those cases, believe it or not, a lot of people don't know that a medical hospital emergency room is a very appropriate place to go to get help when you don't have any other answers. Again, that kind of goes back to what the theme of the evening has been about the stigma. You know, many people just assume they wouldn't deal with this. This isn't a medical issue. That's for, you know, heart attacks and diabetes, and that's completely false. Any emergency room of a medical hospital should be able to provide some sort of stabilization. Now, there are some hospitals that have specific mental health staff in them. UCLA, for example, has a 24-hour psychiatric emergency room. Cedars has mental health professionals who can come in and help. Others don't. But that's always important to know. And it's astounding to me how many people are not aware of that. If, God forbid, there is a case of a crisis, how do you get to the emergency room? So again, sometimes you can convince a person to go. Sometimes it's not possible to convince a person, and they have to be taken against their will in extreme situations. That can be done again. Calling 911, ambulances should be able to help. If you have a little bit more time on your hands, there is something in Los Angeles County, and I think in most major cities, called a psychiatric mobile response team, right? You can just Google it, PMRT, and they have a phone number. They take longer to come, but they're specifically trained in how to talk in a sensitive way to someone who needs to be taken, perhaps even against his or her will, to be able to help them. So that's an important thing when it comes to emergency care. When it comes to non-emergent resources for a family trying to help, where they see someone, for example, starting to slip or significantly slipping, but there's not any immediate threat to life or to safety, there are a number of resources available. One, I saw my friend Mr. Berman, who's here, Daniel Berman, there's a wonderful organization called Relief, and you could speak with him. I don't mean to volunteer you now, but afterwards, to find out about it. They do wonderful work in terms of referring people who don't know where to go, who would be the best type of professional to work with for this issue. He'll sit down and give you sort of a custom tailored recommendations is one great resource. NAMI, not specific to our community, that's NAMA, the National Alliance for Mental Illness, is another wonderful resource. You can go on their website, they have lots of information. They have support groups, meetings, both for individuals struggling as well as for families who are struggling. Another wonderful resource is what's called a partial hospital that many people are not familiar with. That's if someone is really struggling, they're not necessarily at the level of needing to go into a locked medical or mental health facility, inpatient unit, but they need more than just a once a week visit to a therapist. They need something a little bit more intensive. Important to know about this level, where you can go for half a day, right? And you'll meet with professionals each day. You can have therapy, medication management, etc. UCLA has a wonderful one, for example, and others do as well. But the bottom line is we need more, right? And there's such a huge need. And in terms of resources, I obviously haven't listed all of them. I'm sure there are many that I'm not even familiar with. But there's a drastic need for many of them. I know my dear friend Johnny Ritz has really been committing himself yomam v'layla to trying to spread awareness of this and trying to marshal more resources for our community, within our community. I think anyone who has an interest in this, anyone who has the means to help, should absolutely discuss with him. I'd be glad to discuss as well, because there's certainly a lot of room for more resources for families.
Excellent. And as we start to wind up now, there was just one question that came up so frequently that I feel like we should address it. But anyone on the panel who wants to, there was a lot of questions about schizophrenia. Just wondering, is there hope for someone who suffers from schizophrenia? Should we be concerned in shidduchim? What can we say about people who are very nervous about loved ones who are struggling from schizophrenia and feel that there's no hope? Anyone have any insights on the panel? It's just a lot of general questions.
Well, you mentioned shidduchim. I'll just say, you know, I think that with a severe diagnosis like schizophrenia, we're not talking about marriage for someone with this diagnosis, but I assume that the question is, should I enter a shidduch with someone who's got this in the family? Mm-hmm. And as I said when I spoke, I think that unfortunately these kinds of things are being heard more and more today. And it's important to speak with a geneticist, speak with someone really knowledgeable about the genetic risk, about the carryover. Mm-hmm. And I've seen many shidduchim that people rejected and we're told stay away from this, you know, given your genetic history and their genetic history, it's just too risky, and vice versa. I've seen people that enter, you know, families like this and do very well and move forward. So it really does have to go case by case. Mm-hmm. and with help. Mm-hmm.
Any other comments?
So just to reiterate a little bit of what I was saying before, important to realize, you know, schizophrenia is a very, very general term. Such a general term that it's hypothesized in however many years, people will look back and laugh at the fact that we lump everybody together with this diagnosis of schizophrenia. You know, like lumping everyone who has cancer together, Rahman.